I'm Chirag, and today we'll be learning more about troubleshooting and debugging with Beam using the Dataflow Runner. So for the agenda today, we'll be looking at the troubleshooting workflow and the different types of troubles you can run into when deploying your Beam pipeline on Dataflow. The general troubleshooting workflow involves two steps: checking for errors and looking for anomalies in the job metrics tab. So we're going to focus on the first. This involves looking at logs and taking a closer look at the execution graph. When you submit your Beam pipeline to Dataflow, it gives you a list of all the jobs that are currently running or succeeded, and it lets you know the type and end time and all the other metrics about the jobs. This is generally the first place you want to check if there's a pipeline that's not working out as expected. You can see here that if the job is in a fail state, we can click on the job and dive deeper into the root cause. It's also important to note that not all problematic jobs will be in a failed state. So batch jobs will fail. Batch jobs will fail after 4 retries, while a streaming job will fail after an infinite number of retries. So sometimes, more often for streaming jobs, if there is a error that happens further down in the pipeline, it'll still say it's running, but it may not be working as intended. So after we click on the failed Dataflow job, we can check for the errors. It will show us the errors up top here on the header of the job, and we're also able to find the step in which it failed in. Oops, went too fast here. Okay. At the bottom, there's a log section which gives you more detailed error messages, and that can be further expanded by clicking on the little arrow button. This takes you into Stackdriver. Stackdriver is our log monitoring. So all the logs that happen in your Dataflow job come in here, and you can look through it in Stackdriver. So there are many different logs that can be used to help look into jobs. Sometimes the lack of logs can be a good indicator of where the issue might be as well. So for example, we have job message, worker, worker startup, shuffler, and Docker and Kubelet logs. So if you don't see worker logs, but you see worker startup logs, that might be a good indication that the workers weren't able to start up and that you should look into the worker startup logs a little bit closer. The job message log, just stepping into it a little bit more into what each of them mean, is the job message logs, those contain your job level messages and the various components that Dataflow generates. Your worker logs contain messages logged by your code and Dataflow. So if you're using any of the logging libraries to log anything in your Pardue function, or you're logging any external calls you make, this will all show up under your worker logs. Your worker startup logs are present on most Dataflow jobs and capture messages related to the startup process. So downloading your dependencies, installing your dependencies, and so forth. Shuffler, the shuffler logs are the logs that contain work messages from your workers that consolidate the results of all the parallel pipeline operations. So if you're using like shuffle steps such as group by or Pardue functions. Docker and Kubelet logs are the logs, those are logs that are related to public technologies which are used in Dataflow workers. So each Dataflow worker does run multiple containers for different purposes. So after checking error messages in the logs, the next part is looking for anomalies in the job metrics tab. And so what do I mean by that? When you so these metrics here are more specific to the Dataflow runner, and not necessarily specific to your Beam pipeline. But when you submit Beam to the Dataflow service, you get a few you get a few metrics here. One of them is the data freshness metric. And data freshness and next one, system latency, are good indicators of performance for streaming jobs. So the data freshness tells us how old our backlog is, more or less. That's how you can think of it. So you can see between the hours of 9 p.m. to 3 a.m. here, our data freshness was very low, which means that we were able to digest a lot of that data, or at least your Beam pipeline was able to digest a lot of that data and act a lot of those messages, or move it downstream. The increase in data freshness, however, tells us that there were more messages sitting in our backlog than being ingested into our data flow service. So this tells us that there might be a problem with ingesting a lot of messages. Now, another metric is system latency. So while data freshness deals with the oldest piece of data sitting in your backlog, the system latency deals with the oldest piece of data going between the different stages in your Beam pipeline. So they're kind of the same, but they're very different in terms of telling us different things. For example, in this example, the system latency is very low, below 5 seconds, but our data freshness is really high, around 200 minutes, which tells us that our pipeline is able to move the data between all the different stages of the pipeline. But with the data freshness increasing, we can see that we're not able to achieve very high, we're not able to keep up with the throughput in our backlog. So if we see system latency and data freshness go up at the same time, that's usually an indication that our pipeline is like there is code in the pipeline that is struggling to keep up with the backlog. So another more anomalies to look out for. So for all data flow jobs, the CPU utilization graph is a great indicator for the parallelism in a job. And it can also indicate if a job is CPU bound, if all the workers are sitting up at 100% CPU utilization. The latter half of the CPU graph shows a good example of limited parallelism. So the limited parallelism here is that we have many workers sitting below 20% CPU utilization, but then we have one worker sitting up near 100% CPU utilization. This is a good indication of a hotkey. So when we take in work in a pipeline, each worker is assigned a key range, and that ensures that each worker gets all the work for that key, and that it's not, the same data related to that key isn't given to other workers. If there's a key that's too big, we get hotspotting, and we can see that through looking at the CPU utilization graph for cases like this. So now let's talk about the different types of troubles we might encounter. So there are four main types: failure building the pipeline, failure starting the pipeline on data flow, failure during pipeline execution, and performance problems. So let's first start looking at the failure building the pipeline. So these errors are generally attributed to compilation errors in Beam. So while Apache Beam is building your data flow pipeline, validating the Beam aspects as well as your input and output specifications of your pipeline. So these errors specifically can typically be reproduced using the direct runner. So instead of using the data flow runner, we can use direct runner and test against some unit tests. Just keep in mind though that no job will be created on the data flow service if there's an error while building the pipeline building your Beam pipeline. So here's one example of that. So the example here depicts an error where the pipeline is performing an illegal operation that is checked and caught while building the code on the Beam side. So this message would be presented to you if you were in your terminal, if you were to use Direct Runner. You can submit it to the Dataflow service, and it will also show a similar error, but there won't be any pipeline or any execution of any kind on the service. So the next type of trouble is the failure starting the pipeline on Dataflow. So once the Dataflow service has received your pipeline graph and your Beam model is compiled and can be executed, the service will attempt to validate your job. For example, are your PubSub subscriptions valid? Is your path right? Is your Google Cloud storage bucket accessible? Is it created? And it'll also check permission issues. So does your Surface account have the permissions to access different parts of this, of all the services you're using in Dataflow? So checks for permissions and checks for access to different files. So if your job fails the validation process, you will see an error message in the Dataflow logging, as well as your console or your terminal, because it is blocking execution. And in a situation like this as well, there no Dataflow job will be created from your Beam pipeline if the Surface account doesn't have any permissions or can't access anything else. So this error here is an example of pipeline code which passed its validation but was rejected by Dataflow due to the lack of permissions in the project. And we can see that it wasn't able to create the project, but it was able to, it passed all the other validations. So permissions, however, cannot be tested on Direct Runner. Permission issues can only be tested in the Dataflow service itself, just to note. So the next two types of troubles, failure during pipeline execution and performance problems, are probably the two most common types of issues that I've encountered. So we can start by taking a look here. So while your job is running, you may encounter errors in your worker code. These errors generally mean that your do offends in your pipeline code have generated unhandled exceptions, which result in failed tasks in your job. Exceptions in your user code are reported in the Dataflow monitoring interface, as we can see here. And like mentioned earlier, we can actually step into this a little bit more. And when we look at the stack trace, we can see that it's coming from the Org Apache Beam user code exception. So how do we limit that, or how do we prevent that from becoming an issue? Or I guess stopping the pipeline. We can add try catch blocks in our doFN. So in the process method that goes through all the elements, we add a try catch block. And if there is an issue processing an element, we can handle that exception and we can choose to log that and then also tag that element. In our pardo, we can actually have two separate outputs. And so if we tag the good elements that didn't cause an exception, we can tag that as good messages. We can have that go, you know, and continue the normal processing downstream. But if there's a message that causes an exception or, is something that we don't want to go down that path, we can throw the exception, catch it, and then tag it as a bad message. And we can actually return two separate outputs from our pardo. And we can handle this will allow us to handle our bad messages more appropriately, whether it's writing to a dead letter topic in PubSub or writing to a dead letter table in BigQuery. So we can track this, like I said, by using the logging libraries for Java or for Python, and it'll show up in Stackdriver. This will allow us to see the specific elements that cause that cause exceptions. We can also, you know, in the logs, like mentioned earlier, we can check the worker logs or worker startup logs for any errors. And then we can set our Pardue to write the failing elements to an additional output. So anything for dead letter. So dead letter topics or dead letter tables in BigQuery. This will allow us to inspect that later on. So batch pipelines can only be retried. A work item can only be retried up to 4 times, whereas a streaming pipeline can stall indefinitely retrying a certain piece of work. And so the job will fail in a batch pipeline, and that should be more easily visible in your Dataflow console. But in streaming pipelines, because it's going to be stalling indefinitely, it's going to still show a running status in the console. So you can always set monitoring alerts as well and check for high data freshness. You can look at job logs, system latency, cloud monitoring, and any other metrics. So for example, if your streaming data pipeline is reading from PubSub, and you can set a monitoring alert on the oldest unact message or act expirations on your PubSub topic or subscription. And that'll let you know, hey, there's a problem reading from my topic or reading from my subscription. Okay, what are my pipelines reading from that? And then you can go and check your pipelines to make sure that there's nothing that's not working as intended. So another type of trouble is performance issues. A few things that impact the performance issues are pipeline design, data shape, and interaction with sources and sinks through external systems. So pipeline design, that really refers more to how many steps are actually fused together, right? So if you read from, for example, if you read from PubSub, PubSub automatically has 1,024 keys when you read from it, and anything fused to that step will contain 1,024 keys. Going further down. So that could cause issues depending on whether you need fewer keys or even more keys later down in your pipeline. Data shape refers more to skews in your data. So do we see, you know, do you have one key that has way more data than the other? And the other one is interactions with sources, sinks, and external systems. So are you using your sinks and sources appropriately? For example, if you're writing to a relational database, and let's say you're using something like Python, and Python doesn't have a relational database IO connector for it just yet. So you use a third-party connector to write to the relational database. Things like opening up a new SQL Alchemy database connection pool every single time you want to create a connection would slow down your pipeline immensely. So the user interface provides a lot of useful information to debug performance at a step level. So the step info section can provide useful information, including wall time. Wall time, input elements and input bytes. So how many elements are being added to that step in your Beam pipeline, and then also your output elements and output bytes. So going back, the wall time for a step provides the total approximate time spent across all threads in all the workers doing the initialization for that step, the process of processing the data, shuffling the data, and ending the step. The input element count is the approximate number of elements that the step received, and the output element count is the number of elements processed by the step. Oops. Let me go back. So just to take a look here. So here's the Dataflow console. I've submitted a few Beam jobs here. We can see that this one failed. And if we step into that, we can see that it also didn't start anything. And the reason for that is, step into the logs to look more, was because I didn't create a GCS bucket for it. Now, this kind of issue you would be able to find using Direct Runner, but something like permissions, you wouldn't be able to. Now, if we go back, we can see that this is canceled. Now, this one here did succeed. But if we look into what happened, we can see another anomaly here. We can see that one of the pipelines, or one of the workers in our pipeline, stayed at 100% CPU utilization while the other workers were near approximately 2.5%, which shows us that there might have been a skew in data. But another way we can also confirm that is by looking at the wall times here and by looking at the input and output collections. So we can see that our input was 100,000 and our output was about 2. This is another indication that so there are about 2 keys and about 100 million elements, which points to some, you know, and I guess this worker over here was overloaded as well. So that in conjunction with, if we go and look at the worker logs, was operation ongoing for over 737 seconds in our shuffle step, shows that we have a skew in our data when reading that in. And that's another hotkey issue. We can come back to our read step from BigQuery, and we can see that for version 1, we added 100 million, but for version 2, we added 1,000. So it's clear that our data skew had to do with our one key having significantly more data in it. And so thank you all for your time. And if you guys have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.